And welcome to Real Estate Right Now. My name is Jay Izzo and I'm your host, and we are live from the Linda Craft and Team Studios here in Raleigh, North Carolina. We are talking about real estate matters that matter to you. Listen, I'm going to tell you what, today's show is going to be absolutely fantastic. And I have to be honest with you. This is one of those shows where I'm going to start it off in Latin. Caveat emptor. You know what that means, right? Buyer beware. Oh, what do you need to be aware of when it comes to buying your home? Well, actually, there's a lot of things you need to be aware of, right, when it comes to buying a home. And you know what? I have to tell you, this is going to be such a great show because I'm really, really excited because my first guest is the president, CEO, and owner of Linda Craft Team Realtors. Her name is Linda Craft. And in full, complete, and total transparency, she's actually my wife of 24 years. So that's pretty cool too, right? So listen, we're going to talk about what we call the addendum and things that are going on on the addendum when it comes to things that you should know when it comes to buying your home before you buy a home. So Linda, first of all, hi. And Linda's voice is a little raspy. She had a bout with COVID. And she fought COVID. And so, no, she has not smoked 12 packs of cigarettes. She's just got a raspy voice. So what we're going to do is we're going to make adjustments in her as we move along here. But it's going to be just fine. So, Linda, tell people, first of all, how long have you been in real estate?
So 37 years.
Not possible.
I know. It's how I feel. But, it's an amazing career. You know, I think one day we're going to do a show on how to start a career in real estate and just how tough it is, right. To get past a few years. But it's wonderful, wonderful now.
So we're going to talk about this addendum, and the topic today is buyer beware, right? And you told me a story how this whole thing started, actually. And I think it might be a neat way for us to help the audience understand how you came up with this addendum is the story, because I think the story is kind of is a great way and something I think people can learn from as well.
Well, I want to back it up a little bit further than my addendum that I think is so wonderful. I want to talk about what a buyer should know about a house.
Okay.
Because they really need to know everything, mm-hmm. and they know very little. Most of the time when a buyer purchases a home, they see a home that they like the way it looks, and the way it looks is not everything they need to know about a house. So when you look at buying a home, you know, you go out, you find a home you like, about the only information they get is what is in the MLS listing and what the seller has filled out as far as a property disclosure. And most every state in the United States has some sort of property disclosure that is required. They're all different. It's state by state what they ask. So in North Carolina, our property disclosure asks about right now present conditions of the home. So for instance, when you go to a doctor for the first time, they take a medical history. They want to know what kind of illnesses you've had, if you've had any surgeries in the past. They try to get that entire picture about you. In North Carolina, they may have had a plumbing leak, but they don't have to disclose that. They just have to disclose whether or not it's currently leaking today.
Right.
So as you look at the property disclosure, which has some good information as far as age of roof and HVAC and that sort of thing, doesn't really tell you the history of the home. So when I started building my team in the late 90s, one of the things that concerned me was whether or not my buyer agents would know how to disclose all the things that a buyer really needs to know about a property. And so, you know, fear is a great motivator. So I had a fear that they wouldn't know everything. Right. So, I don't rely on the property disclosure even to this day. You know, when we're meeting with listing clients to sell their home, it's amazing how many people don't know if they have gas, heat, or electric, or the difference between a heat pump and forced air. Right. And so, you know, and then after they go under contract, of course, they're going to have a home inspection, which is wonderful. However, it would be nice to know more about your home before you actually have a contract, a legal binding contract, and potentially quite a bit of money down, non-refundable. So I created this addendum, which I want to talk about, because I feel like a buyer really does need to know everything. And it's a 4-page addendum where I literally sat down and wrote out everything possible that I felt like a buyer should know about a property. And websites and phone numbers where the buyer can get more information about each of those things. and also a signature page at the end so that I know that my buyer agents have actually reviewed this document to fully inform their buyer clients. And, you know, in the past, we've had quite a few shows, and this is actually my first show that I've been on. So thank you very much.
You're welcome.
But I've had many of the brokers that work here at Linda Craft team, and, you know, they are so smart and they are so good.
Right.
But this is a wonderful tool to educate and prepare. Would you like to know some of the things that are on it? Let's highlight.
Cause I don't know we'll be able to make it all in your segment. But let's highlight some of the big things, that you have going on in terms of this addendum.
I'll just give you some ideas of what's on it. And some of these things.
And then I may stop you and ask you to kind of, if you can, maybe give me some more detail.
All right. I might let you do that.
Okay. That's great. This is great. Thank you. Thank you, honey, for allowing me to do that. That's awesome.
I know. So here's just a few things just to give you an idea of what's on it. Aluminum wiring, asbestos, crime rate. People should check that out. Floodplains. They're constantly changing. Homeowners insurance, you know, I gave you an example of with our North Carolina disclosure. And again, some states are so good. Their disclosures are more like a medical history where you really learn everything that's happened in the home. But we have on here about homeowners insurance, because as a buyer, you've looked at the seller's property disclosure. It says that nothing is leaking. What it doesn't tell you is that in the past, they had quite a bit of water damage from a leak.
Right.
And they filed a homeowner's claim for insurance to repair all that damage. So nothing is leaking right now, but it may be that when you buy that home, either you can't get insurance on it because of the previous damage, or you're going to pay a higher rate. So you would like to know that information before you go into
you can find out that information.
You absolutely can. Yes, they can. And so this is information that we would want to research and know. More importantly, because it's one thing about money, it's another thing about quiet enjoyment and your health.
Right.
If you've had a water leak, high probability that you may have some mold in the home. And if you're highly sensitive to mold, we would want to make sure that we had a mold test along with a home inspection to make sure that the house was going to be a healthy house for you.
Okay.
We also have meth lamps, believe it or not. This is the world
I was going to ask you.
I don't know a whole lot about those, trust me, but I know they exist.
Well, you do provide a website that's associated with this. It's DEA.gov, right? And you can, and people can check. Matter of fact, DEA.gov is the national website that you can check if you
absolutely
right. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So lead-based paint. Obviously, we talked a little bit about mold, different building materials that have been used over the years in homes. And, you know, we create this new building product. We think it is amazing. We get down the road a few years and we find out it wasn't so good.
Right.
So some of our plumbing, like polybutylene and PEX fittings, were problematic.
Whoa. You got to back up. You just used the word PEX.
Yes.
PEX, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's that we didn't pronounce it wrong. It's not pets. It's PEX, PEX. So it's PEX fittings, not pets fittings. So PEX fittings, does this have to do, is this again a polybutylene related issue?
You know, I think we had a problem with polybutylene that they thought they had solved with PEX. And it turned out it was a problem too. So just to give you an example, polybutylene was used nationwide from 1980 to about 1995.
Mm-hmm.
They had two different types of fittings used with that product. One was plastic and the other was metal. And what happened is over time, the plastic fittings started to break down. They broke down because of water pressure. They broke down because perhaps a home was on a well instead of city water, and the well had a lot of mineral content. That would cause it to break down.
Mm.
Even if it's in the city, it could have too much water pressure. That could cause it to break down. And so we had a lot of leaks. And for a while, there was a class action suit, again, nationwide. And after a homeowner had three leaks from the polybutylene piping, insurance companies would come in with a class action suit and replace all of the plumbing in the house. So whenever we look at our property disclosure, it does ask if you have polybutylene piping. And many times the owners will say that they've had it replaced. So as a real estate broker who wants to protect our buyer's best interest, we want to know, did they replace all of it? Did they replace it in the entire home? Did they replace the part of the plumbing that goes from the street to the house? Or is that perhaps still something that could be an ongoing expense for our client? So anyway, after Poly B Lane failed, about 1995, in 1996, they came out with a product called PEX fittings, which also started to break down. For those, it was because they had zinc in them and they would, again, just, you know, start to leak. So today, most new homes are built back with PVC. So hopefully you won't have any problems with PVC.
So I'm going to stop you because Paul Fitz just chimed in. He's watching. Hi, Paul.
Hey, Paul.
And he said, you know what? It's not just meth labs. And this is going to be kind of funny because what he said is it's also moonshine stills.
Oh, great. In North Carolina. Yeah. Possibly, so especially in the mountains.
So he said, whatever. He says it's meth labs, but moonshine stills too. So that's okay. Move on. Yeah. What else you got?
Yeah, so, you know, airport noise, if you are train tracks or odor, sanitary landfills, all of those things should be disclosed. If you have power lines close by, we may want to do some testing then to make sure the house is safe and not being having too much exposure. Pressure treated wood, you know, there's arsenic. And if you think about a lot of our decks, playground equipment, et cetera, is made out of that. So, you know, it's not that you shouldn't buy a home if it has it. You should just be aware of what's in it. So,
because most of this stuff is correctable, right?
You know, really everything is, but it's also your comfort level.
Oh, okay. You know?
For instance, we keep bringing up meth labs and we said we were going to talk about that.
I know. Well, I mean, somebody chimed in. So
Paul Fitz, thank you. And moonshine stills. Yeah. You know, I would never want to own a home that had a meth lab. I wouldn't feel safe in that. Right. Even if we cleaned everything out, which I think is impossible, but I still wouldn't feel safe. I wouldn't want to own a home where the crime rate was really high.
Right.
And so those are some of the things. People think about schools and think about room count and, you know, if it has a garage that they really want, those kind of things. Mm-hmm. But a lot of the stuff they just don't dig into as much as they should. So let me give you an example of how, you know, my radar goes off. So typically you sit down with a new buyer client and you will ask the question about what you need and you want in a home. And they'll say, I would like to have 4 bedrooms and at least 3 baths. I know no one ever uses a dining room, but I really would like to have a dining room. I'm starting to work from home a lot. So a space in the home where we could have a home office would be great. Mm. My husband would love to have a garage. Fantastic. And then we ask, you know, what price range are you going to be comfortable buying in? Because what you can afford and what you're comfortable with may be two different numbers. Right. So we want to make sure they stay within their budget. And then we start asking about what location they want. Mm. So let's say that they say, you know, I really love inside the Beltline. Every city, wherever you're at, you know, in the country has an area inside the Beltline where you have older homes and mature lots. And usually they're very quaint or maybe even majestic. They're just really unique, beautiful homes. Right. My antenna says, they're probably going to have asbestos because of the year that they were built.
Right.
And so I want to make sure that they know about asbestos. And it's absolutely not a problem until you decide to replace the windows or redo the siding or knock down a wall. And then when you break up the asbestos that is in insulation and flooring and exterior components of the home, that's when it becomes a health problem. So you would want to know that you know, before you bought a home like that.
So I'm going to jump in on here real quick because Darlene Herrings has jumped in with a question that maybe you can answer. And she wants to know, how do you test power lines?
Well, you personally can't. You have to hire a professional to be able to do that. And you know what? Can you look up for the number they need to go to?
Sure.
Let's see.
Power line, that's just the EMF here in North Carolina. Darlene, that number is 919-541-3419. And this is the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences. You can also go to Progress Energy, which is progress-energy.com to find out more. Or if you're a Duke Energy person, it's duke-energy.com. And you can, you know, search up EMF because that's what we're talking about, electromagnetic fields, transmissions, high voltage lines. But the number is typically 919-541-3419. Darlene, thanks for asking that question because it's a great question. So we really appreciate you paying attention. I see Jeff Snell is talking about lead paint here as well.
Let's go to that next.
Okay, let's talk about lead paint. Thanks, Jeff.
All right. So talking about, you know, the antennas that go out. go up for me. Let's say that someone says that I'd like to live in the North Hills Midtown area, which is a really hot, revitalized area in our city, or North Ridge, which is our country club golf course, beautiful community. Both of those areas, great location, really good resale, high demand to live there.
Right.
Great. But what I think of is they were built in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. They're doing some tear downs and there's some new construction as well. So when I think about 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, the home that they're looking at to buy could have asbestos, could have lead-based paint because it was built before 1978. Right. It's definitely going to have it.
Right.
It could also have aluminum wiring based on the time period. It could have hardboard siding, which takes on a lot of moisture and a lot of wood rot, a lot of maintenance. It could have polybutylene piping. Mm-hmm. So it could just have so many things that you just really want to check out. And lead-based paint, I mean, if you think about it, it was anything before 1978 is when lead-based paint was used. That paint has been covered up by layer after layer after layer of latex paint.
Well, let's hope so.
Let's know it does. Well, it's a really old house. Really no old maintenance. House. Right, that's right. Another problem.
That's another problem, isn't it?
But where lead-based paint does become a problem, and I've literally seen this, is that you may have a pet that just loves to chew up the door jams. And so that chews long enough, it's going to hit some lead-based paint and be a problem. The lead-based paint is actually an addendum that is a federal required addendum on any home built before 1978. And that is because they literally have had children who have probably cutting teeth, chewed on handrails and gotten down to the lead-based paint and had lead-based poisoning and died. Mm. So the only thing to know about lead-based paint is basically don't eat it. Make sure your children don't eat it and your pets don't eat it, because you're never going to get it completely out of a home unless you reshut. Well, yeah, it would be a lot.
Right.
The other thing I want to talk about today is radon.
Oh, yeah. That's a big topic, radon, isn't it?
Yeah.
And it's become more of a, I mean, in the last 20 years, it's probably become even a bigger issue, right?
Yeah. So we always recommend with every home that our clients purchase that they get a radon test. And even if they're buying a home, let's say it was sold 5 years ago and that person did a radon test and it was in within EPA standards, we still recommend that our new buyers get another one because it changes all the time. And for those of you that maybe do not know what radon is, it basically, it's the decaying of the soil, the rocks, the things that are happening in the ground. And so since the ground is always shifting and changing and many things can cause that to happen, from hurricanes and tornadoes to just natural settlement in our earth core, it's allows the gases to come up into the homes. So everywhere you go, right now, Jay, you and I are breathing radon.
Oh, no.
We are. But I've had this building tested, and it's really low, and I've had it tested a couple of times. It's really low. But, you know, if you continue to breathe radon and it gets trapped in your home, it causes lung cancer. If you are someone who smokes or lives in a home with a smoker or anything that you smoke, your chances of developing lung cancer goes up because of the presence of radon. If you spend a lot of time in the home, and today, you know, we spend a lot of time in our homes, we're working from home, spending more and more, you have a greater chance of exposure. So you want to have a radon test. And even if you've owned your home for a few years, it's worth the money. It's not very expensive to have another radon test done just to make sure that nothing has changed. Right. It's easy to mitigate radon. So it's not like if it's in your home, you know, you've got to vacate your home and never move back in. It's easy to mitigate it. And once you put in the system to do so, you should really never have radon ever again.
Okay. So I guess this is one of the things, you know, we've had Kim Komen and Jeff Snell is just shooting things at us like crazy right now. Architectural shingle failures.
He's so smart. Look at him with that synthetic stucco.
Synthetic stucco.
That's on my list too.
That's on the list too, Jeff.
Just so you know, I didn't do all four pages.
Jeff says, point being, so many potential health and financial remediation risks need an experienced real estate broker, is what he's saying here.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. You know, and I love that. Thank you so much, because this took me 37 years to learn. I mean, just imagine someone who got their license this year and is trying to represent a buyer. They're just, they don't probably know much more than the buyer.
Right.
So it takes a long time. And as you said earlier, everything can be fixed.
Right.
But it costs money.
The biggest thing
is that a lot of people are living with mold in their home, radon in their home. They have no idea because they've never been advised to get it checked and rechecked. Right. Someone also asked about EMF. I just found out about a company here in our local market that I'm going to be hiring, by the way, to come to the house and check every outlet in the home, all of your electrical, to see how much you actually have in your personal home. And there's ways to reduce that.
Really?
I'm just going to check it out. We've got a lot of electronics going on in our house.
Yeah. Yeah. That's interesting. I had no idea that was part of it. I want to go back to radon for just a second here, because I think people may be confused. That's not something that a home inspector does, right? It's a separate test.
It's an additional test that we highly recommend. Right.
So
in parts of our country have high levels of radon and parts of our country do not. So for instance, if you're at the beach, sandy soil, probably don't have high radon. We also know we have maps to show where the radon is. And when I mentioned North Hills, Midtown, and North Ridge, those happen to be two areas that are pretty high on radon. In fact, one of the highest radon levels I ever saw was in a crawl space, which you don't usually see in the Midtown area. So let me talk a little bit about construction and radon.
Okay.
If you have a basement home, that is a concrete slab that's pretty low in the ground. If you're on a slab home, concrete slab home, those concrete slabs, whether it's basement or your foundation is slab, trap the gases underneath. And with time, they seep in because concrete is porous. They seep into the home. Today, we're building our homes, thankfully, very economical as far as energy efficiency. But that means they're really tight. So we're not opening windows, and we don't have as many ways for the clean air to seep in and the bad air to seep out. So radon literally gets trapped in the home. So we find high levels with basements. We find high levels with slab construction. And if you live in either one of those, I would say every maybe 3 to 5 years at least, get it tested. It's only about $150 to do a proper test. You can buy the kits at some of the hardware stores. They're not nearly as good as having a professional come out and put a machine in your home and just measure everything in the air in your home over about a 72-hour window.
So one of the things that you have on this addendum is air traffic noise abatement area. Is that really a big deal? I mean, air traffic is air traffic. I mean, you can't, it's kind of like somebody said once, you know, why don't you move the deer sign to a different location so that the deer cross there, you know? And it's like, okay, well, air traffic is air traffic. I mean, what do we, is it direct air traffic? I mean, cause you can hear a plane anywhere, can't you?
Yeah. When you know, when you're going on vacation, you want to get to the airport really fast. Yeah. But if you're living close to the airport, you're obviously going to hear some noise.
Right.
And we do a lot of relocation, and people will come in from other areas. They love the schools. They love the convenience of certain areas, but they are also going to end up with some planes going over their head. And we literally have a map that shows what the sound decimals are for the different areas so they can see how far they need to go. The reality is, if you live within 30 minutes of an airport, sometime or another, you're going to have an airplane flying over. It's just whether or not you're in the takeoff or the landing. By the way, do you know which one's noisier, takeoff or landing?
I do not. Honestly, I do not. Which one is?
It's takeoff.
Takeoff is noisier than...
Because they got to have up those jets and be able to take off.
Okay, yeah, you're right. Why if I didn't think of that?
And so usually the airport will show you the direction if they're doing, and sometimes they switch it based on airflow and that, but... The people that live in areas where they do have planes that fly over quite low, they will say that after they've been in the home for a while, they don't even notice the planes anymore. But someone relocating, someone not familiar, they need to go out and experience the sound before they ever think about buying a home in that area.
Right. Okay. So structural pest control.
We're referring to termites. In North Carolina, because we are a warm, moist client. We have a lot of termites. And so it's important to always, when you're purchasing a home, get a termite inspection. The property disclosure in North Carolina that the seller fills out will ask the question about whether or not they have had any termite damage in the past and if that damage has been corrected. So you can have termites and not have any structural damage if you catch it early enough.
Right.
If you have termites for a long period of time, you potentially could have some structural damage that would need to be repaired. But because we are one of the states that right. does have a lot of termites, it's really wise, certainly before you buy a home and maybe even every year, or at least 2 years, have someone come in and check for termites.
Okay, I got to ask this one because it seemed a little odd to me. And I wondered if people were going to ask this, wondering about it. But underground fuel storage tanks.
So occasionally people will not have natural gas and they don't want electric to fuel the cooktop mm-hmm. or their water heater or their heating system. And so they will bring in LP gas, and LP gas needs to have a tank to hold it. Sometimes it's above ground, sometimes it's below ground. Right. Important to know, make sure that it's not leaking. The other thing that's important to know about LP is you can lease the tank or you can purchase the tank. Mm-hmm. And I recommend, if at all possible, that you negotiate and purchase the tank.
Why?
Because then you can negotiate how much they're going to charge you for gas every year. So if you're leasing it, whatever they're charging for gas, LP gas, that's what you're going to pay. If you own the tank, you can move to any provider that you want to. So you can call the different ones and see right. what they would quote you for the next year.
That's pretty cool. That's good. Okay. Is there one special one on the addendum we haven't covered that you think we should cover at all?
I think floodplains.
Okay.
You know, there's 100-year, 500-year, 1,000-year flood zone. That should always be on a survey. I highly recommend that you have a new survey. So, because even though the seller has perhaps provided a survey from when they purchased the home, if there's any water near that home, if there is a creek, that floodplain can change. Mm-hmm. FEMA decides where the flood maps are going to go. And flood insurance is not terribly expensive. Mm-hmm. But, you know, certainly if you're in a 100-year floodplain, that means every 100 years they expect that the property that is in the floodplain could actually flood. So you'd want to carry some extra insurance.
Yeah. And by the way, people can get information from FEMA.gov, right? FEMA.gov. And if you're local in the, and by the way, you can also go to ncfloodmaps.com. So that's North Carolina Flood Maps, ncfloodmaps.com. So you've been on almost 30 minutes. Can you believe it? It's gone by really fast.
It goes so fast.
It really does.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, thank you for being on. So I know that I ask this question all the time, and it should be so obvious, but how can people get a hold of you?
The best way to reach me is Linda at LindaCraft.com.
That's so crazy, but it's really true that you've been great. I mean, this is fun. We didn't know what was going to happen when you and I did this, but I thought it turned out pretty well.
I think so. And by the way, since I was thinking about what I was right. going to do,
right.
I'm having a mold test done in our home tomorrow. Okay. And I had the radon test was dropped off today because okay. I thought, you know, it's been a while. I should check it out.
So don't open the windows is what you're telling me.
Yeah. Keep those windows closed. Thanks for having me.
Thanks. Okay. All right.
Bye, everybody.
Send Heather in. That was Linda Craft, president and CEO, Linda Craft team, Realtors. I'll get that correct. Here, my next guest coming is Heather Williams with the First American Home Warranties. And I pray that I got that right. Right? First yes. American, right? I did get that correct.
First American Home yeah. Warranty, yes.
And by the way, just full disclosure, I am not married to Heather. So we had to do that, right? Because I have to be full disclosure about, you know, Linda and everything like that. So first of all, thank you for being on.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. And so the home warranty, how long you've been doing this home warranty thing?
I just celebrated 19 years in April. It's been a long time. Yes.
Really?
But I love it. Yes. They've been wonderful. It's been a great career yeah. and I've had all my children since I've been with First American.
Wow.
It's been great.
Wow. And of course, you know, we've known you coming in here to the Linda Craft team office. I got to get rid of the ampersand, the Linda Craft team office that you've been coming in here. So for people, we just covered Linda's addendum, which covered so many different things. What is a home warranty? Just help people understand what that is.
Yes, it is a service protection plan for the systems and appliances in the home that fail due to normal wear and tear. So,
okay. So, systems. Let's talk about when you say
right.
systems and appliances, what are we talking like?
So we're talking about mechanical for sure. Okay. We really don't cover anything structural. So, okay. you know, plumbing, electrical, heating and air, water heater, Some of the appliances are included in the basic plan, and then there's different things that you can add on extra.
Okay. All right. So, typical question, I can hear somebody screaming all the way from France or another part of the country somewhere, or maybe even in this area, saying, okay, I have homeowner's insurance. Why would I need a warranty? Are they same or different? So why is that?
They really don't overlap at all. Home warranties, home insurance are totally different. A home warranty, again, is just for your normal wear and tear, mechanical failures, whereas your homeowner's insurance may be more for fire damage, water damage, things like that. And I can give you an example.
Yeah. I'd love an example.
How
yes.
they don't overlap, but how they yeah. might coincide yeah. in yeah. a certain yeah. situation.
Absolutely.
So let's say, for example, a homeowner has a dishwasher that leaks and water spills on the hardwood floors and damages the hardwoods. If they have a home warranty, they can place a claim to have an appliance contractor come out and repair whatever the issue is with the dishwasher for the mechanical portion of it.
Right.
But then the secondary damage is not something that the home warranty would cover. That would be more of the homeowner's insurance. So they could choose at that time to reach out to their homeowner's insurance.
Okay. So the dishwasher blows up. It ruins the hardwoods. You're not covering the hardwoods. You're just covering the dishwasher.
Correct. The dishwasher repair.
Got it. So that's a really good clarification for people.
Right.
Because I mean, first of all, you know, some of these dishwashers can be expensive.
Oh, yes.
We have a Bosch. I know how expensive it is, right?
And they're just not making them like they used to. So, whereas, they're really not lasting as long.
Right. That's, no offense, Bosch.
No. I'm sorry. I did not mean Bosch.
No.
Some of the appliances in general.
No. I'm having fun with that.
Because used to have, where they would last 20 years.
Now,
4 or 5 years might be.
Right. Okay. Okay. All right. So that's awesome. Good for you. So let's talk about changes in the home warranty programs and the markets.
Yes.
Because we were in this crazy pandemic market, and now we're kind of coming out of the pandemic market. Things have changed. So talk about the market in terms of what you've seen in the shift in home warranties.
Yes. Thank goodness. I'm so glad, because in a more normal paced market before the pandemic, sellers would oftentimes offer a home warranty with their listing.
Right.
And we hadn't been seeing that over the last couple of years because it was such a crazy seller's market. They weren't offering any extra concessions, really. Buyers wanted to present a real clean offer. They weren't asking for home warranties. But just over the last month, we're starting to get all those questions again. I'm starting to hear about buyers asking and sellers agreeing to pay for a warranty. Some sellers are starting to offer them upfront again. And of course, each property is going to be unique, but especially if it is older or, maybe a little bit further out or something from in an outer line area, they're definitely getting back to offering home warranties.
So I'm thinking about, during that time, during the pandemic where people were just buying homes as is for a lot of money, was there another way? I mean, does it always have to come through the seller, or could they have purchased
it? No, and that's what the buyer could definitely have gotten their own, and they just weren't. There weren't that many buyers getting it, and it's crazy because that was a time where they really needed it more than ever.
Right.
I mean, during the pandemic, people started working from home more. Kids were at school, doing school at home, so the systems and appliances were getting used more frequently than normal. Things were dying faster, and it really would have been valuable for them to have a home warranty. But, I think since they were putting so much extra money into the cost of the home, things like that, they were like, well, now I don't want to pay for something extra. But they really need to be thinking ahead about budgeting, because they're probably not, the fact that they put all this extra money into the home, probably not saving for unexpected repairs that were going to inevitably happen at some point.
Yeah. So I'm thinking, one of the things I was thinking about when I was asking that question was, it's even if a seller doesn't, even in this market where things they are, sellers may occasionally, it's still something that maybe you want to ask your buyer.
Definitely.
Your agent to representing you is going, hey, I know they don't want to do this, but I think I may want to get, that hot water heater has been around for about 10 years.
Definitely. Have the conversation. And then, if the agent brings it up, that's what I'm here for, to go over questions. If the buyers do have questions that the agents are not comfortable answering, I'm always here to talk with the clients as well as the agents and explain how things work.
So you have this timing of coverage.
Yes. So For a buyer, it's going to be 1 year from closing if they get our real estate product, which is what we would typically offer when you're going through a transaction.
So they get a transaction.
Yep.
It's going to cover all your appliances.
Yep. Not all. Well, it depends on which plan they choose. But yeah, some of the appliances. And it will start as of closing. But this product is designed to be handled, the payment handled via the closing attorney.
Okay.
So we set up the order, send the invoice to the closing attorney, and then they can collect the funds from whichever side is paying. And the attorney mails us a check. There's a grace period to get payment in after closing and everything. But then the buyer has that protection from day one in the home and continues for 1 year as long as we get the payment within that grace period.
So it's, but technically it starts at closing.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
Well, that's good to know because, you know, you close and sometimes maybe it takes a day or two to get into the house. And
yes. And if something does happen before we get the payment, there's not a wait period to place a claim. So they are able to still place a claim because sometimes it might take a couple weeks by the time it gets to our home office in California to get the payment processed and everything. So the buyer still has that protection then. But it is, the home warranty is designed for things that are in good working order at the start of coverage. So.
Right. Okay. So you're saying that, meaning that what?
Well, we definitely recommend home inspections.
Okay.
Very important. Just so that they have the right expectations. I mean, if there are things that come up, hopefully the seller might agree to do some repairs, but if they don't, then that way the buyer has the right expectations of what they are going to need to be prepared to pay for on their own outside of the warranty. And then the warranty is there to protect them for things that are working as of closing that failed throughout that first year in their new home.
What are some of the typical things that you see, you know, fail? Just typical, you know, is there a typical thing that you go, well, this happens more frequently. We see this more
frequently. I think heating and air is a big thing. Oh. And, you know, sometimes, especially when people are even just moving in, everything might have been working fine. And I've had buyer agents call me in a panic just a couple days after closing. Oh, my people are trying to move in and the air goes out. So it's good to have protection for that. Yeah. Like we're talking about dishwasher, stove, built-in microwave, just plumbing leaks, but it is for things within the main foundation of the home. So that's important also.
Oh.
So not any of the plumbing outside of the foundation.
Okay. So I think really good point though is heating and air is covered.
Yes.
Typically.
Yes.
Right.
Yes. And so there's a service call fee due with each claim.
Okay.
And if it's just a repair, then that's usually all they'd have to pay. But it is very important for people to know that if there's a full system replacement needed with heating and air, there would be some non-covered costs involved, but it's still a huge savings versus if the homeowner didn't have a home warranty and had to pay for a whole new system out of pocket.
Right.
It's definitely worthwhile to have that.
Now, I know that you're here in North Carolina,
yes.
But you have, there's places across the United States.
Yes. Yes. We are across the U.S. Our plan is specifically for North and South Carolina, but, we can get them, you know, if people are moving to a different area, we can certainly get them in touch with the right plan for that area.
And it's not a tremendous amount of difference, right? From area, is it?
No, there might just be certain things that are more regional that there might be one or two differences that they offer coverage on
that we may not hear in our two states that are typical for us. Okay.
Right.
I mean, I think that's important for people to know.
Right.
Pre-existing conditions. Let's talk about that because we kind of led into that. And, you know, let's talk about the pre-existing thing because I'm sure, it's kind of like going to the doctor and we've.
Right. And so we do have some protection in the warranty for something that's truly unknown, meaning there's no way that they could have known about it by doing a simple mechanical test. Like, is it even coming on or a visual inspection? Is it something that you can see just by looking at it? So that is there to protect them. But any kind of obvious known conditions, they're not going to be covered if they were already going on before coverage began. So, and that's, you know, all the home warranties across the board are like that.
Right.
And you would be surprised. There are some people that really don't realize that.
Right.
They think that then they might be able to get a warranty to take care of things that are already broken. And so it's important for them to have the right expectations.
So I'm hearing that maybe there's different levels of warranty too.
Yes, that's true. Yes. We have a basic plan and then we have different options you can add on a la carte. And there are some upgrades which can offer enhancements to heating and air coverage we discussed that can help lower those out-of-pocket costs somewhat. So I definitely recommend going with those if it's an older system.
Right.
That's in the home.
So one of the things Linda was talking about, and I know that I know you're not covering meth labs.
No.
But there are some things that she was talking about in her addendum that maybe you do cover. And I think one of the things that you and I talked about was polybutylene piping. That is actually something that you do that can be covered.
Yes.
In a home warranty.
We treat polybutylene plumbing just like the regular plumbing coverage that we offer. So, now they're just going to repair a section of the pipe that's actually leaking, though. Right. I think Linda mentioned the class action lawsuit from before. It's not like we're going to go in and replumb an entire home just because it has polybutylene.
Got it.
It is just specifically going to be a repair to that section. And then, like we were talking about the secondary damage a few minutes ago, again, that if there's some kind of a leak in a ceiling, gets secondary damage, things like that, that is not something that we would cover.
Right. So we're having a leak in one part of the polybutylene piping. You're going to cover that leak and that piece. We're not covering the entire.
Right. Just that section of the pipe that needs the repair.
Yeah. That's a real important clarification for people because I don't want them to get confused about, going, well, they said polybutylene piping. Well, no. We're going to repair that section is covered, not the whole thing. And I think that's really important for people to know. What's one thing you would want buyers and sellers to know that we haven't discussed yet?
Well, I think the biggest thing for me is just having the right expectations about how the warranty offers a lot of great coverage, but again, it doesn't cover everything. So it is important for people to see the brochure. We have a really nice glossy brochure for people going through a real estate transaction where they can see the breakdown of coverage. I know not everybody takes the time to read all of that, but then you have some people who are very detail oriented who do want to know. So again, I'm always happy to talk with people, but I think a good way to explain the warranty in general is just that it can help offset some of the major expense of things that will go wrong in the home.
Now I've got some questions that were going beyond what we have on paper, that I just think that I have in my own head. Okay. So I'm not part of a transaction. Mm-hmm. Can I still get a home warranty?
Yes. Yes. We do have just consumer plans that they can get set up on. So they're welcome to reach out to me and I can get them connected with the right information for that. Those types of plans can be broken into monthly, like automated once a month credit card charges also.
So
you don't have to pay in full upfront necessarily, or you can.
Or you can do a year.
Either way. Yes. One year at a time.
You can do 1 year at a time.
Now for our buyer plans, we do have some 2 year discounted bundle packages. So if there are ever some extra funds left over at closing, then the buyer can get some extended 2 year.
Or you're kind of like going, okay, yeah, the dishwasher's working okay, but I'm feeling like that pump's on shaky ground. Right. A little bit. Right. Is that maybe extended out a little bit?
Yeah. I mean, I think, well, and people do have the option to renew, of course, after the first year, but it's just a little bit better price
savings
of a discounted. To do it 2 years up front.
And I think one of the things, and maybe we need to get specific here on some of the things like hot water heaters covered, right? Because we keep talking about dishwashers, stoves. stoves and ovens.
Right. Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Covered.
Kitchen, refrigerator, washer, dryer are options that can be added on.
Okay.
Yes.
So
because typically what I'm involved with is people going through a real estate transaction and those don't always convey with the home. So we try to keep those separate so that if they are going to be buying brand new of those three appliances, they may not need ours for the first year.
Right.
Because they'll have that manufacturer warranty that comes with it.
Oh, that's an interesting proposition because if they don't need it the first year, they may have to come back to you.
They could add it on at renewal time if they decided, if they continue to renew.
So is it possible, I know this is sounding convoluted, but is it possible like, okay, you bought the new refrigerator, but you had a warranty on everything else. That refrigerator goes out of warranty at the end of the first year. Can I add the refrigerator?
Yes. Yep. At renewal time. You just can't add it middle of the term.
Okay.
But at renewal time, you can definitely change options, add or remove extra options that you might have. So,
what is the best, like, that feel good story that you've ever had when you were going, man, I am doing the right thing. What is that one where the, do you have a story where you go, you know, this happened and I was so glad that we pushed and that they had the home warranty.
Right, right. Well, and I am not really involved in every claim. I don't hear about all the details. I just hear when agents come back and share stories with me or if homeowners reach out. So I was actually in a meeting today with some other agents, and one of the agents has had our warranty on our house for a long time and just spoke up about how many different appliances and systems that it helped her out on throughout the year. So it's there are some people that will really continue to renew for years and years to come. So just knowing that you're helping out save money with the budget and everything. And
well, I don't think what we're thinking about here is when we talk about home warranties that, you know, what we're really talking about here is the cost of sometimes replacing it or getting it repaired is so expensive compared to what you're going to be paying in a home warranty.
Right. It's really about peace of mind. Peace of mind, and especially for people going through a closing, they've put so much money into all the different inspections they have to do, things involved with moving. They don't have that extra money. So it's really great to have that budget protection, at least for that first year after closing, to have the home warranty set up.
And what's per peace of mind worth? Right. I mean, it's really hard to put a price on that. Right.
But
I mean, and I'm thinking here too about the first time home buyer. Mm-hmm. Right.
And, oh, definitely.
Right. And
that's probably the most important for them.
Right. Because the first time home buyer, there's so many things that you're not thinking about as a first time home buyer.
And a lot of first time home buyers probably have not even heard of a home warranty. I know when I was a first time home buyer, I didn't know what one was.
Right. Right. And it would
so be, it's very important for the agents to share that information and let them know that it's available.
Right. Yeah. I'm thinking like, gosh, you know, for the little bit amount of extra money that you're going to be spending, man, you can just have that extra peace of mind and just not think about it.
Right.
And it might be something that you want to, as a first time home buyer, or even any buyer for that matter, push your buyer's agent on, you know, saying, hey, you know, we should get this.
Right.
You know,
right.
And, you know, let me ask you this. I'll just ask it this way. Do you ever see it on a new home?
So that is a good question. We do have a new construction plan, actually.
Oh, okay.
Now, typically, we wouldn't want to overlap with what the builder is offering.
Right.
Most builders are going to offer the 1 year from closing. Sometimes they might not, though, if it's a really smaller builder. So we could definitely do it directly from closing. But we do have an extended plan for years 2 through 5, which I think is very valuable. I know I didn't get my home warranty on my own house till around year 5, and at year 4, the blower motor on our HVAC went out and cost several hundred dollars.
Right.
And, you know, I'm hearing more and more stories from people, like we were talking about, how things just don't last as long as maybe they used to. And so I think it's definitely worthwhile
to
have
that.
And it's a great price for all 4 years. It's one price you pay at closing, but then it doesn't kick in until year 2 and continues through year 5.
I got it. So it's a new home warranty.
Yes. And new construction.
New construction.
Yeah. Multi-year. And yeah, it's something that they would still need to get at closing, though. They can't get that discounted price later.
Okay. So, okay. Now I've got another one I'm going to throw at you.
Okay.
Here it goes. So can somebody who is buying a home as an investor, can they get a home?
Oh, yes. We have lots of investors and people who do property management also.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Oh, yes. Yeah, we have lots of people who have warranties, and we just put an alternate mailing address on file for them.
Okay.
So they can still, then the property manager can place the claim. We actually have a whole program for property managers as well, separate.
Really?
From our regular buyer-seller plans.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So, now this is fun. Now I'm asking these questions. All right. So, and I know these aren't on the sheet. So
all
I know.
Right.
All right. All right. So, any difference between a single family home, a townhome, or a condo?
Yes. We have the one prices for a single family and all of our prices for under 5,000 square feet.
Okay.
It does go up if it's above that. And then we have a separate plan for condo, townhome, or mobile home pricing.
Whoa.
Mobile home,
did you say mobile home?
Yes.
Really?
Uh-huh.
Really? I had no idea that there was okay. So I get a home warranty on my mobile home.
Yes.
For my stuff in my mobile home.
Mm-hmm. Same appliances, systems.
That's crazy.
Yep.
That's crazy. All right. So and the more I'm hearing about this, right, the more I'm like going, okay, it just makes, if you're, whatever you're buying, it just makes complete sense that you would go, well, why wouldn't I, why would somebody not do it? I mean,
well, and if you don't mind, one thing I would like to say, just from the seller's perspective and the fact that we are getting back to more sellers offering warranties, a couple of things that just make sense for the seller to offer the warranty up front. So first of all, if you're maybe in a little bit of a cookie cutter type neighborhood and there's two or three homes for sale on the market, offering a warranty may be something unique that sets you apart from the others. Or if you're in a home that maybe not that old, a little bit newer, but competing with a bunch of new construction, offering the warranty is going to give that peace of mind to the buyer. So, and then the seller can get some protection while they're listed for sale. And the bulk of that is going to be the same price as what they would pay, whether they order it at the start of the listing or whether they wait and order it the day before closing. So they might as well benefit from that and sign up, have the protection during the listing, as long as they're willing to provide a warranty to the buyer at closing.
Right. That was the question.
Need to, it is with the intent they're going to pay for it at closing for the buyer.
So here you are selling the house. Mm-hmm. Go ahead. I'm going to get a warranty, but for me to do that while I'm selling the house, I am going to provide a warranty to the buyer, whoever's going to purchase the house.
But you don't pay anything until closing. It's all paid for as part of the closing.
So
they sign up at the start of the listing. The seller term is up to 180 days or until closing, whichever happens first. But then the buyer still gets a full year of coverage from closing. But that way the seller has some protection while they're listed for sale, in addition to all the different marketing incentives that they
Smart.
Yes.
So smart to do, because you never know what's going to happen when you're selling a house, right?
Right.
I mean, things can just go bad.
Right.
Right.
And we were talking about, what if the seller doesn't want to make any repairs? Well, if they're living in the home and something goes wrong, that's something that they use on a daily basis, they're going to probably need to get it fixed. Especially if they've got another month until closing, they're going to be living there.
Right.
It just makes sense for them to have it.
And right now the heat index is 105.
Yes.
Right. So, I mean, we're putting a lot of pressure on our cooling units right now.
Definitely.
And so, I mean, if you're selling a home, you're like going, okay, well, I don't want anything to happen to my, heating and cooling system.
Right.
So this would probably be a good thing for me to do.
Yes, definitely.
Actually do that. This is cool. I really didn't. I mean, I knew a little bit about what home warranties covered. I just didn't know all the details that went into it. I didn't know that investors could do it.
Okay.
I had no idea. I didn't know that sellers could do it as long as they provided. I didn't know that. I didn't know there was something different between condos, townhomes, single family homes. And I didn't know there was a new construction as well.
You learned all kinds of things.
I did learn all. Okay.
I appreciate you having me on.
You're welcome. Is there any other condition that I didn't cover that you could think of?
There's always so many things I could talk about. I have a couple of stats here from
my company
put out. So over 53% of our customers experienced a major home system breakdown in their first year of coverage.
Wow.
And over 31% of our customers placed a claim within the first 90 days after start date.
So it's not as rare. It's not a rarity. It happens.
Yes, definitely.
This is awesome.
And honestly, the people that have issues and need to place a claim are the ones who are going to be more likely to renew because they've seen the value of it.
That's awesome. Okay. Yeah. I have kept you here long enough. So now what you need to do is you need to tell people how they can get a hold of you. Because by the way, it doesn't matter what state they live in. If they want to even find out somebody like you in their state, you can refer them.
I can get them connected.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, and actually our website, if you go to fahw.com and then click on the real estate professional section.
Right.
You can put in the zip code of the property and it'll show you who your area manager is, which is what I am. It'll get you to a link of our sample contract for real estate transactions. Right. I am available by phone. You may read off my cell phone.
Yeah, whatever number that you prefer people get in touch with.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I just have people call me on my cell phone. It's 919-818-0453.
Okay. You want to repeat that one more time? Because we should do that. Because, people are going to be listening to us on a podcast too.
Okay.
And they may be driving. And so they're trying to remember the numbers. So one more time.
919-818-0453.
Okay. And how about an email? Can they get
a hold? Yes. in. It's H.L. Williams, W-I-L-L-I-A-M-S, at firstam.com.
firstam.com, yep. Mm-hmm. Right? That's awesome. You've been terrific.
Oh, well, thank you.
You have been absolutely fantastic. I know that when you came on here, you weren't sure what was going to happen.
I know. This was my first time doing a podcast.
Right? And it wasn't bad, was it?
No.
Right?
Well, you're great at prompting with the questions and everything, so you make it easy.
Well, thank you. Stay with me. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the show. This is Real Estate Right Now. We are live at the Linda Crafton Team Studios here in Raleigh, North Carolina. Listen, I know that you have a lot of choices, and you know what? You chose us, and I thank you for that. So as I say to you every week, everywhere, thank you, everybody, and ciao.